It's 23andMe time. We're going to do a new review for 2019 of 23andMe. Howdy, I'm Andy Lee with Family History Fanatics, and this is a segment of DNA. Be sure to subscribe to our channel and click on the bell if you want to be notified about upcoming episodes. Now, about a year ago, I did a review of 23andMe and gave you the things that I liked and the things that I don't like about 23andMe. I'm going to update that and try to give you some new things that I like and some new things that I don't like, but there's still going to be some overlap between those. So let's get started. The first thing I like about 23andMe is the ability to do triangulation on the website. Now, 23andMe will tell you when you triangulate with two matches, and you can also see the triangulation within the chromosome browser, and I'm going to show you both. If you are looking at a match and you scroll down to the matches you share in common, what you see is you see this area of shared DNA where it's either yes or no. When it's a yes, that means that you triangulate between those three. Now, clicking on that yes takes you over to the chromosome browser. And since I know I triangulate between those, what I'm looking for is I'm looking for the places where all three of us share the same DNA. And you can see there's actually just one segment down here on chromosome number 18 that we share the same DNA. And so I know that the three of us triangulate at that one point. The second thing that I like about 23andMe is the relative prediction map, I guess you could call it. And why this is really useful is because I get confused sometimes as to where certain relationships may fit and which common ancestor I should be looking for. Now, every company gives you the predicted relationship, and it might be second to third cousins or second to fourth cousins, something like that. But unless you are looking at these all the time, it's kind of hard to figure out whether or not that is a great-grandparent or a great-great-grandparent or what kind of great-great-grandparent it is that you might share in common. And so 23andMe provides this easy-to-see graphic that shows where you are and it shows where your match is or where your match likely is. That helps narrow down how you want to be looking for your common relative. The third thing that I really like about 23andMe is their robust matching algorithm. And what I mean by that is, based on the analysis that I've done between 23andMe and all of the different companies, even though 23andMe provides you with the least number of matches, the amount of shared DNA between those matches and yourself is as much or more than almost all of the other companies. What this likely means is that 23andMe is already doing a lot of the hard work of filtering out those matches, particularly the ones with much smaller amounts of DNA, that really aren't related to you. They're false matches. And only giving you the ones that are true matches where there's actually a relative that you might be able to find in common with them. Now, I showed a video about quality matches and basically came to the conclusion that their algorithm is probably 10 times better than the nearest competitor as far as the ability to find quality matches. So those are the three good things I love about 23andMe, but there's some bad things that I don't like about 23andMe. First, the lack of a tree. Now, 23andMe originally was partnered with MyHeritage, and so you had a tree function as part of the website. But since that partnership has been dissolved and MyHeritage has gone their separate way, 23andMe has been left without a tree that you can be able to share with other people and see on their website. They do have the ability that you can put a link to a tree outside of 23andMe, but a lot of people I found don't even know about that feature and it's never filled out almost 100% of the time. So it's really a useless feature. I would like 23andMe to actually include a tree building map where at minimum you can upload a GEDCOM file to show how you fit into your known relatives. Number two, 23andMe seems to have you opt into everything. Now, I'm sure this is probably a consequence of some of the legal issues that they had several years ago, but a lot of this should be able to be taken care of with a single opt-in when you sign up rather than an opt-in onto every feature that you want to see. So I'd rather see that 23andMe condenses their opt-in down to just a single opt-in so that you can get it over with and you don't have to worry about it. Now, where that has been a problem has been because of some changes in the 23andMe website over the last couple of years, people have had to re-opt in to a lot of the features. And so in some cases, your matches that may not have been on the system in a while have not gotten on, and so they're not opted in, and so they're not even showing up anymore. Number three, and I ragged on this last time, and I still rag on it, is the messaging system. The messaging system on 23andMe seems to be very, very clunky. It is difficult to get in and see where all of your messages are. It takes a long time to load each message, and usually I try to get off of their messaging system as fast as possible. Whenever I am messaging somebody on there, because it is the only way to contact people initially, I always provide my email and my phone number so that if people want to contact me, they can contact me outside of the 23andMe messaging system. So those are three pros and three cons about 23andMe. I still use the website, I still love it, and I would recommend it to anybody who's interested in genetic genealogy. Now, if you have any questions about 23andMe, put it in the comments below, and I'll try to answer them. And if you like this video, be sure to give it a thumbs up and tell your friends all about it.